Good morning. It's good to see each and every one of you here this morning as we gather around God's Word and God's Sacrament. And this morning we're going to talk about what everyone wants to talk about at church. Money. All right. And so that's going to be the focus of our message this morning. We begin by singing our opening hymn number 730, What is the World to Me? And we'll have our CDs today, so some of our hymns are going to be a little tricky because they have a lengthy introduction, so just be patient on some of them. Please stand as we turn to page 151 for Divine Service Setting 1. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our introit printed on our insert. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted. I will bless the Lord at all times. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. O magnify the Lord with me. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, your divine wisdom sets in order all things in heaven and on earth. Put away from us all things hurtful, and give us those things that are beneficial for us, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. I now invite any children forward for a special message. Well, good morning, Ryan. All right. I'm so glad to have you here today, Ryan. I want to tell you a story about this. You know what this is? It's a drone. You're right. Oh, hey, come on up here. All right. Yes. So I have here with me a drone. Now, it probably doesn't look like a normal drone to you, does it? No, it doesn't. It's a drone that Eli received as a Christmas gift last year for a board game called Drone Home. All right, so this is a special drone where you get to flick aliens onto the drone, and if they stick, right, it lights up and it flies and carries the alien and the drone away. And the goal of the game is to get all your aliens to fly away first. Okay, it's a fun game. This thing is really cool. It goes right, and I can catch it. And we take the alien off, and we do it again. It's a lot of fun. We played it about 10 times or so, but then something happened. The drone broke. The wing broke right where the screw is. Okay, so guess what I had to do? I had to go online, order a new wing. Okay, so then we had to wait for it to come and all that fun stuff. It finally came. Exciting. So Josiah decided to fix the wing, right? Put the new wing on. And he lost the little tiny screw. So guess what I did? I started looking for screws online. I have over 500 tiny glasses screws. And none of them fit. So it was permanently broken. Then a month ago, I come home, and Josiah says, "Dad, I found the missing screw." I don't know how we can lose this tiny screw and one day find it again. But he did. He found the tiny screw. And he put it in, and the drone is restored back to the way it's supposed to be. And then we tried plugging it in to charge it. The charger is now missing. So now we have a fixed drone, but now we can't charge it up because our charger has somehow disappeared. And all the other chargers that should fit in here don't fit in the little hole to charge it. I tell this story because it reminds me of money. Money, we always have to have something more. We never have enough. And then just when you think you got it all figured out with money, then you need even more money, or another bill, or this or that happens. Right? And that's what happens with our love for money. Our Old Testament reading today, our first reading, is a warning from King Solomon about money and what it can do for you. King Solomon might have been the richest person in the world when he was king. And yet he writes, money is dangerous because you can't have enough. You need more. Something's always missing. Something more is needed. And then when it's all said and done, when you die, you still can't take it with you. It becomes worthless to you, much like this drone is worthless. but God has something greater for you. A paradise in heaven that won't fail you, that won't break down, that won't get lost. A place where everything will be perfect for you, and you will be with God. You will be perfectly happy in paradise, and it's not something that you earned with money. It was earned by Jesus shedding his blood on the cross. And it's given to you freely through your faith in your Lord Jesus Christ, who loves you more than money can ever love you. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks that you sent your Son Jesus to die on the cross to forgive us, to give us a sure place in heaven. Help us to understand the truth about money, and help us not to love money, but to love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks, boys and girls. You can return to your seats. Our Old Testament reading for the 21st Sunday after Pentecost comes to us from the 5th chapter of Ecclesiastes, verses 10 through 20 on page 707. And our Old Testament reading does contain some of Solomon's wisdom about money. It's a toiling after the wind. There is never enough. No one will be satisfied. You can't take it with you when you die. We read, "He who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income. This also is vanity. When goods increase, they increase who eat them. And what advantage has their owner but to see them with his eyes? Sweet is the sleep of a laborer, whether he eats little or much. But the full stomach of the rich will not let him sleep. There is a grievous error that I have seen under the sun. Riches were kept by their owner to his hurt, and those riches were lost in a bad venture, and he is father of a son, but he has nothing in his hand. As he came from his mother's womb, he shall go again naked as he came, and shall take nothing for his toil that he may carry away in his hand. This also is a grievous evil. Just as he came, so shall he go. And what gain is there to him who toils for the wind? Moreover, all his days he eats in darkness and much vexation and sickness and anger. And behold, what I have seen to be good and fitting is to eat and drink and find enjoyment in all the toil with which one toils under the sun, the few days of his life that God has given him. For this is his lot. Everyone also to whom God has given wealth and possessions and power to enjoy them and to accept his lot and rejoice in his toil, this is the gift of God. For he will not much remember the days of his life because God keeps him occupied with joy in his heart." This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading comes to us from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, beginning on page 1285. And we've been promised true rest in Christ. Although the Old Testament is filled with examples where God had earned their rest, they disobeyed and lost that rest. Our epistle reading calls us to strive for that rest that is found in Christ alone. We read, "Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them. But the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest, as he has said, 'As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest.' Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, 'And God rested on the seventh day from all his works.' And again in this passage he said, 'They shall not enter my rest.' Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news failed to enter because of disobedience, again he appoints a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterward in the words already quoted, 'Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts.' For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand and we'll speak together the Alleluia verse. Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. And we read verses 23 through 31, beginning on page 1082, where Jesus reminds us that it's impossible for any man to get into God's kingdom on one's own. Not even the richest among us can get themselves into heaven. Rather, we need God to come and do the impossible to save us. We read. And Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how difficult it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said to them again, children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. Peter began to say to him, see, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel, who will not receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brothers and sisters and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated as we continue with hymn 725. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the past few weeks, I have found myself reading the Minor Prophets and the Prophet of Isaiah. And to me, there's been a very powerful image that connects Isaiah and the Minor Prophets to Israel's unfaithfulness. That they were turning, the people of Israel were turning to idols of wood, gold, and silver. Things that were made with human hands. They couldn't talk. They were lifeless. Inanimate objects that people were foolishly bowing down toward and paying huge sums of money for. When we look back at those people, some of them erected a golden calf, or they carved a piece of wood, and then they said, "Here is your God." We almost can't help but laugh at such foolishness. Yet I would contend that we have a very similar idol today. It's made by human hands. It can't talk. It's lifeless. It's an inanimate object. And yet people will do almost anything for it. They'll pray for it. They'll bow down toward it. They will sacrifice their own bodies, their own families, their own faith, and everything that makes someone unique for it. The idol I'm talking about, of course, is money. Now, I hear a saying that goes like this: money makes the world go round. And although money can't talk, people still says money talks. But it's an inanimate object. It's as lifeless as those Old Testament idols. And yet it controls your daily actions. I mean, it makes you go to work. It calls you to save some for later. It offers you a better life. And it's an extremely powerful God in this world, and even in your own lives. Now, this isn't anything new, right? Solomon in Ecclesiastes warns us about the power of money. And Paul would tell us that the love of money is the root of all evil. And Jesus tells us that it would be easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to get into the kingdom of God. Now, in its most basic sense, it should be no contest. If we were to pit God against money, God would win. God should win. The Lord who made this world out of nothing is far more powerful than the highest stacks of cash. The Lord who spoke just a few words and then poof, the sun, the moon, and the stars appeared is far greater than the trillions of dollars in this world. The God who doesn't change is much more reliable than the dollar bill, whom we hear his value is changing depending on the day. Our Lord can answer your prayers. Money can't say a word to you. Our Lord ended up becoming a living, breathing human being who forgives you and loves you. Money's just a transaction piece that has no forgiveness and only demands your love and doesn't love you back. And yet the sad fact of the matter is, when it comes to your attention, money wins in a landslide. For the sake of money, people will get up every day and work, even if it means a third shift job for 8 hours to be able to pay the bills. But if worship lasts beyond an hour, we get worried that people will stop coming to church. We choose work over worship, money over prayer, money over health, money over almost everything else in our life. When the church wants to do something like spread the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, one of the first questions I always ask: how much does it cost? how often our schools opened or closed, not because Jesus wants us to teach children, not because we can be a shining beacon to families with a solid Christian education, but rather by asking the question, how do we pay for this? Most churches I know today that have closed, it's not because they weren't faithful enough, but they closed because they couldn't pay their bills any longer. They couldn't afford their own pastor anymore. And yes, even though money is lifeless, we still say when money talks, people listen. When God talks, we hope people might listen. Now, the world's made its choice. Money is the ultimate idol. For us as Christians, it's a little bit more challenging. I mean, we know the truth. We know how important money is in this world. But we acknowledge the truth that God is Lord of all and is more powerful than money. But even recognizing and believing all that, we still foolishly chase after money as the answer to all our prayers, concerns, and problems. So it shouldn't really be surprising that Jesus would say something that says how difficult it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. Even Jesus' difficult saying is a warning about having too much money. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And although it's easy to get confused about that line, I think it's meant to be absurd because people's love of money has become absurd. Money has become the be-all, the do-all, and the end-all. It causes political fights. It causes divisions amongst family members. It makes people covet and steal. It makes more people jealous. It demands more and more of you, and yet it's never satisfied. It always needs more. Money is, interestingly enough, constantly changing, especially today with the stock market, inflation, worldly values, and cryptocurrencies. And money shows the truth about everyone. That we still have a lifeless idol. That we still aren't perfect. We have a long way to go. When Jesus answers the disciples' question about who can be saved, Jesus tells us the truth. With man, it is impossible. But not with God. For all things are possible with God. For no amount of heaven can get you in, no amount of money can get you into God's kingdom. There's no amount of lifeless cash that can be paid to get you into God's eternal paradise. Oh, but there is a price to pay. But by the grace of God, it isn't paid by you. Rather, your admission price is paid by Jesus. For God sees you in your sorry state, and unlike money, he stopped demanding more and more of you. He sees the people who have all the money they could possibly have and how they become the least. He sees the people who have devoted themselves to money and left God behind. He sees our own inclinations to put our trust in money more than God. And he says, enough. Only I can do something about this. And he does. And he pays the ultimate price, the ransom price, to get you into his kingdom. He pays the price even when it's beyond even money's cost. He paid the price with the blood of his only son on the cross. For in the cross, Jesus was willing to pay the redemption price you have to be in his kingdom. I mean, it's absolutely amazing. Jesus sees you chasing after this idol of money, and he still chooses to chase after you. He still does the impossible and saves people dominated by the love of money. And he promises you a better age to come, where money will no longer be an issue. Money will be forgotten. Those debts that weigh you down will have been eliminated. Those savings accounts that you count over and over again will be gone. The rise and fall of stocks. Those money worries that just won't let you sleep. Those family squabbles about whose money is whose. They will all be forgotten. They will be gone for good. And then there will only be us and God, living a perfect life, a life that does not end, a life that does not need money to provide food or drink, a home that won't be taxed or needing repairs, a life that won't require you to pack up all your stuff and move to get more money. For you will be with God in his new heaven and new earth, and you will be celebrating that the impossible happened, that people like you and me who have foolishly chased after money too often have wisely been chased by Jesus. You money-loving people, by God's grace, you will be in God's perfect kingdom, and will all be because of Jesus, who forgives you, who pays the price, who welcomes you into his kingdom forever. And in that day, it will no longer be said, money makes the world go round. Rather, I think it might be said this way, God's grace makes this kingdom the perfect place to be forever. In the name of Jesus, amen. We now continue our worship by speaking together the Nicene Creed found on the last page of your hymnal. Please stand. We confess together, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead. His kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, and I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In our prayers this morning, remember those listed in our bulletin. We also include Lois Stone, who is currently hospitalized. We include Joel Kepke, who had his appendix taken out this week. And we pray for our auctioneer from our dinner auction, Joe, who also had to have surgery recently and is recovering. We continue with prayer. O God, with us salvation is impossible, but with you all things are possible. Give boldness to your church to proclaim Jesus Christ our Lord, by whose death and resurrection the way to your kingdom has been opened. Lord, in your mercy, spare the servants of your church from love of wealth and from fear of the difficulty of their task, that they would gladly set aside every comfort of your, for your sake and for the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, lead our households to find eternal rest in your Son and his Word. Give fathers and mothers diligence in teaching their children. Preserve us from all hardness of heart. Give us urgency to hear the good message of salvation today. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, Guide our nation and its leaders in true wisdom to promote honest labor, temporal protection, and fitting enjoyment under the sun. Guide your Christians to serve Christ in their citizenship and callings. Do not let our hearts be occupied with the vanity of riches that perish, but with the true joy of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. When the righteous cry, you hear them, O Lord, and deliver them out of their troubles. Draw near to save the brokenhearted, the crushed in spirit, the sick, and those in need, especially Lois, Joel, Joe, Eileen, Marcy, Myron, Larry, Helen, Jerry, Ken, Shirley, Mary, Bridge, Christina, Marion, Joel, and Iona. Lord, in your mercy. Since we have a great high priest, Jesus Christ, your Son, hold us fast in our confession through all temptation and preserve us from sin, O Lord. Give your protection to those who find themselves in abusive situations. Give them the strength and grace to make the right and God-pleasing choices moving forward. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, continue to shower your blessings on Trinity Lutheran School. Help us to be beacons of light pointing to the truth about your love and grace. Provide what we need to continue to learn and grow together so that we may continue to serve you through our school. Lord, in your mercy. Comforting Lord, be with the family of Cindy as they mourn the loss of a dear lady. Comfort them with the truth that Jesus came to destroy death for all who believe and promises resurrection to come. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for our offering. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and its blood on the cross. Gather in the name of the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. Thank you.
We turn to page 164 to sing together, Thank the Lord. Please stand. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you refresh us through the salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his favor on you and give you peace. Amen. Remain standing for our closing hymn, 922, and just to warn you, there is a lengthy introduction. Please be seated. Well, it's good to see each and every one of you here this morning as we gather around God's Word and God's Sacrament, as we're reminded that we still love money, but God's love is greater for you. A couple of announcements. This coming weekend, the 22nd, they're cutting up wood if you can help, and Saturday, the 23rd, they're cutting, splitting, and stacking if you can help them out, and there will be lunch provided. And they need one more splitter for Saturday. So if you have a splitter they could possibly use on Saturday, contact the church office so we can make sure we can get it there in a timely manner. Let's see here. I believe, if you want, the book fair is in the basement, and you can still stop by and purchase some books, right? Right, Mr. M? Yes. Do we know how much we made and how many sales we've had? I just know there's a certain level we want to reach, and then we get like a higher percentage of the sales back to the school. So I was hoping to announce that, but don't have those numbers. All right. Any other announcements? Mrs. Jonas. Yeah, so thanks to everyone who helped us string 10,000 pretzels onto necklaces. So judging by my driving yesterday, everyone was leaving the place very happy. So I'm sure the necklaces helped. Yes. All right. Then let's conclude with the Bible verse of the month. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. God's blessings to each of you this week.